Welcome to Women's Wealth, the podcast with me, Joanne. My mission is to educate, inspire, and empower you all to step into your own life of wealth.
Hello, welcome back. Welcome. If you're watching me on YouTube, you might notice that I'm behind the desk rather than at the side of the desk. I had to have a change. I needed to be facing the window so I can get some natural sunlight when I'm recording and sitting at the desk, and I can be nosy to see what's going on outside as well. So today you will have seen the title, The Truth About Being a School Teacher and Why We Need to Protect Our School Teachers. Now, I have a huge list of things that I want to go through today, and I'll touch on how, why I'm doing this podcast and what kind of inspired me, I guess, or something annoyed me that I saw online. And I was like, oh my God, why are we still doing this? Because it's more important than ever that we protect our teachers' well-being. There's so much going on in the world, so many reasons why we need to be working with teachers rather than against teachers. Now, I can only talk from a teacher's point of view, and I don't know how parents can be mad at teachers, because I'm just going to share this and I'll get into the meat. In schools now, they have a lockdown procedure. There's a tannoy, it goes off, and there's a secret code, Sandman is in the building, and we know where we need to go, we know how we need to lock down, and the teachers are protecting the students. So when I see that online, and the person that mentioned their teachers called their teachers N-A-Z-I. It wasn't their teacher, it was their son's teacher. And N-A-Z-I, I don't think I can say it. I think it'll get blocked out on the podcast. That's what they said. So their teacher was one of those. And in my head, I was like, you do realise that if there was a mad gunman in your child's school, that your teacher would be in front of your child protecting them, and you're calling them that. So I think there's a lack of understanding of why teachers do these things that may come across as annoying, what they actually think of them, and I can tell you now because I'm not a teacher, so I'm not going to get into trouble, and how we can work together to support teachers. And I know a lot of you listening to this may be a teacher, or you may already think, like, I do this anyway, but it's just going to be, you know, that TV show that used to be on in the UK, The Undercover Boss, kind of like that. So I'm the undercover teacher, so I'm able to give you the inside scoop, because as a teacher, they wouldn't be able to be this honest. So I was a school teacher for coming up to 12 years before I left. And some of the things I'm going to share with you today are reasons why I left. I graduated with a degree in English. I actually took 5 years out. And I feel like this also gave me a good sort of reflection point for well-being in the workplace. I can't even tell you how many jobs I've had. I started work when I was 16. I worked in, I don't know if you're from the UK, you might remember All Sports, which is a sports shop. I was a Saturday girl. There was two of us, the Saturday girls. And oh my God, I think I got paid about £50 a month. I must have been on £2 an hour. And working all day on a Saturday, being told to approach customers, and I'm an introvert, quite shy, and I didn't like that bit. And selling on and selling shoe care, all of those things, I used to hate it. But then obviously I grew. I also had a waiting on job around the same time. So I had two jobs. Then I worked in a shoe shop. I actually got Sunday supervisor in the shoe shop. So I must have been about 18 then. Still worked waiting on. I was also then bar staff. I then worked for Vodafone in customer services for a few years. I always had a bar job at the side of this. That's when I was at university. I left Vodafone and I did car insurance, phone insurance, what else? Recruitment for a while. These were all obviously on the phones, not customer facing. And then I decided that I wasn't cut out for an office job, and I worked in care. So I worked in community care, two different companies, and then I worked in a dementia home. Then I finally was like, right, come on, you need to do something with your life. And I got a job in a school as an assistant to begin with, and a pupil referral unit, actually, not a school. So, which is basically a naughty kid school. And then I applied for my teacher training. I did on-the-job teacher training. It was called a graduate teacher program. So that was after about 5 years of being in and out of all of these other jobs. And so with that, you just literally rock up in September, you're working, you have a 30% timetable, you gradually work up to a 70% timetable, but you're on the job, you're learning. It's like an apprenticeship, but you're teaching. And it was for graduates. It's different now, but you had to be over 25 to do that. So it wasn't fresh out of university, I'm guessing, because you've thrown in at the deep end. So that's my working and how I got, you know, teaching background. I can't remember ever really thinking I'm going to be a school teacher. When I left college, I wanted to be a lawyer. I was obsessed with Ally McBeal. I was obsessed with Sex and the City. I wanted to live in New York. I know Ally McBeal wasn't New York. I think it was Chicago. But I wanted to live in New York. I wanted to be like Carrie Bradshaw, Samantha Jones, and, you know, high fly businesswoman lawyer type. So that was my aspiration at 16. And then I did law at college and found it really difficult. And I was really good at English. I was really, really good at English. So I was like, okay, maybe I'll go to university and do English. It's my best subject. What am I going to do with it? So I toyed with journalism, other things, and it's like, you know what, I actually feel like I want to be a teacher. I went into some schools and I really enjoyed it, and I enjoyed helping the students, and I was like, yeah, I feel like this is something that I would like to do. I didn't want to work with children, so it was teenagers, and obviously they're still children, but there's young adults. I think the pupil referral unit actually really solidified that I enjoyed working with, and I was always the best at working with the young people that did need support. So some of my favorite students, I'm actually still in contact with them, are a little bit naughty. They used to annoy some teachers, but I was like, come to my classroom. If you'll be naughty, come in the classroom, chill out, because I knew that they just needed a bit of time. And same for girls. So girls that were going through things, they'd always want to come and chat to me. And I was kind of like, you know, this is fine. I think it's because I was young and approachable. I don't know. Anyway. So I loved that part of being a teacher. The turning point for me was when I started to really focus on my own health and well-being outside of school. And then I realized how much being a school teacher was affecting me health and well-being wise. So, you know, my hormones being out of balance, anxiety, all of the things that I was dealing with. And I was like, oh my God, I'm not supported, and I can't do this anymore. And I loved the teaching part, but everything else that went with it, I was like, this is just too much. This is not what I want to do. I don't want to be a data analysis. I don't want to be a marketer. I don't want to, oh God, all the other crappy things. I actually went to speak to my head teacher, the last head teacher that I had, to say that I didn't feel supported in my well-being. And I was literally, it was the icing on the cake. It was kind of like he was solidifying that, you know, they don't care about you. He told me, oh my God, some of the things you won't even believe. What more do you want? You had donuts in the staff room. He also said to me that I was a big, when I said another member of staff was really rude to me, he was like, well, you're a big girl, you can handle it, can't you? He said to me, maybe this is not the school for you if you feel like this. He was horrible, horrible. I left the wellbeing meeting crying, saying that that's it, I'm done. I'm leaving teaching. I cannot work here anymore. I gave myself another year and that was it. I was at the time doing my yoga teacher training, and this is when I was really starting to get interested in my own holistic health and how I can support my own wellbeing, because they weren't doing it with me. So I stepped away, and that's why I'm here today. I feel like teaching definitely has, you know, like Instagram versus reality, it 100% is that. So when you imagine being a teacher, and I'm guessing people who are not teachers probably imagine like, oh yeah, it's so many holidays and, you know, you're fun, it's in the classroom and everyone's happy and the children are all happy and there's no behaviour issues and, you know, like you see in the movies sometimes, but it's really not that. The teaching part is the best part. Being with the kids, the children, the students, whatever we want to call them. In high school, we'd say students. I'll say children, teenagers for today on the podcast. That's the best bit. But then everything else that goes with it is what pulls it down. And it's the everything else that goes with it, which is the majority of the job. It's the everything else that goes with it that you're not actually paid for. I don't know any other job that would ask you to stay an hour, 2 hours. Like, my partner today left the house at 6:30. He's at school until 7:30 tonight. And he will still own, he doesn't get paid any, school starts at 8, finishes at 4, and he's got his after school, so he's paid 8 till 4, is that 10 or 9 hours? We actually worked out the other day, because he's going through the motions at the moment of suffering with his own well-being. We worked out that he does 46, 47 hours a week, which is already 10 over, but those 10 over are not overtime hours. They are just expected hours. And when you break it down, it works out that teachers are paid around £20 to £25 an hour. So, which is kind of standard for other jobs where he's got a master's, well, I have a master's, that highly educated degree, master's level, and you're not paid that overtime. You're not given any extra. You're not even given the chance sometimes. I hit the ceiling in my last teaching job because I taught for, because I was there teaching 10 years. And in the UK, it's better because you push through and you can pick up an extra role, or they try and push you through an extra role, you get onto the upper pay scale. But I was just told, you've hit the ceiling. Done. Like, in most jobs, you're offered things. You're pushed through. There's chances of promotion. I can't think what the word is. Loyalty. You've been there a long time, so, you know, this is what we're going to give you. And I found that in the other roles that I had, even though I wasn't working in them for as long, the other roles, there was a lot more. Like, when I worked at Vodafone, that was the best well-being ever. We had Medicare. It wasn't free, but it was very cheap. Sorry, it was with Bupa. They would come regularly and they'd do your blood pressure, blood finger prick. There was coffee and tea and water, and there was a canteen with reasonably priced food. You would get a break, you could leave your desk, you know, go to the toilet. Teachers don't get any of that. I was paid also similar on when I was working at Vodafone. I was also paid overtime. I used to make so much money doing overtime, whereas teaching, you're not. If they asked you to stay, you knew that you were getting time and a half. In teaching, it's kind of expected that you do stay. You go into it expecting to make a difference. However, there is the pressure, the excessive workload, scrutinized testing, teachers are scrutinized, observations. There was that horrible story a couple of years ago of the head teacher that actually took her own life because of Ofsted coming. And Ofsted's horrible. They come in, they scrutinize. I know they've changed it a little bit now. It's still a little bit of a scrutiny out here. They're a little bit behind. But these pressures do impact you. Imagine doing your job and there's someone that comes in the back of the room and they're looking for things that you're doing wrong. They do say these lesson observations are meant to support, but they don't. And you don't sleep the night before, even though you know you're a good teacher. Because if on that day you don't ask the question in the right way, or the wind's blowing in a different direction, and this is a thing when it's windy, the kids are wild, it's, or the weather's off, or it's raining, then that observation, you then get on a list, and you do not want to be on the list. So even if it's just a bad day, you can't just say, oh, well, normally it doesn't happen like this, or, you know, he's in a bad mood today, or she's in a bad mood today, or, you know, I wasn't quite sure. You know, you have to get it right on the spot when someone's in that room. Whereas, you know, with my job now, I can go, oh, I made an error, sorry, and, you know, left foot, right hand, say something slightly wrong, and, you know, it's okay, I can put it right, and then there's no one at the back. Oh, you said that wrong. So what we're going to do now is put you on a list because we think you need support. And what that actually means is eventually you'll get pushed out. So maybe start looking for another job, because that's literally the list. That's the list. And teachers won't seek help because they don't want to be on the list. And this is a list that no one's going to mention this list to you. So this is one of, maybe this is the whistleblowing bit, because it's not an actual list. We just know it exists. My friend, who is just, 4 weeks into the new term, sent me a voice note last week, 2 weeks ago, and she was crying. And I actually said to her, I was like, can you speak to somebody to ask for support? And I knew what she was going to say, no, because you get put on the list. And that's what her reply was, that I can't, because they'll see it as I'm whinging, or they don't see it as you're asking for help. It's whinging, you can't do it, so let's get her. There's that. So there's the physical and emotional strain. Now, again, these things you won't consider, but all the jobs that I've been in, teaching is the only job where you can't pee when you want to. You need to pee, you actually can't. It's strategic peeing, because you might be on break duty. So if you've had lessons in the morning and then you're on break duty, so you haven't been able to pee because you've got your lessons, you're teaching, you've got to be on the corridor checking for the kids. So you can't go to the toilet because you're not doing those things. So by the time it's break time, if you need to pee, but then you've got to go on duty and someone is on your back, where have you been? Well, I was having a wee. Like, this is how it is. You have to be on your duty spot. If you leave your duty spot, you know, it's, so you'll see they're walking around so fast all of the time, probably because they need to pee. They need to pee and then they need to get somewhere else. They also don't have, so again, in my other jobs, you would be on your lunch. When I was waiting on even, I would go in the staff room, I would eat. The customers weren't sent upstairs to me knocking on saying, oh, sorry, can I have sauce? Can I get some sauce? You know, someone else would deal with it. As a teacher, no matter where you are, if you're in the office, you're in your classroom, someone's gonna knock on the door. Someone will want you at break time or lunchtime. They're going to. Or the kids wanna come sit in the room, so you can't really eat and properly, and you're still watching the kids, or you've got lunchtime club or lunchtime duty, so you never actually get any time away. And you're not going to turn them away because you care. Not an N-I, I can't spell it, N-A-Z-I. Not one of them, because they're knocking on your door and you're just putting a mouthful of salad into your mouth. And they want to come in because someone's stressing them out, or they've got period pains, or they're tired, or they don't want to be in the canteen because it's too loud and they're stressed out. So you let them in because of all of those reasons, and you care. So you don't get that time away. You rarely get time to plan. So you've also got all of the lessons that you're teaching, but when are you meant to plan these? And this is when there's no overtime, or, you know, working from home, you don't get paid. So the main part of teaching is, being a teacher is teaching, and you have to plan the lessons, but you don't necessarily have time to plan those lessons in work, in school. Now, when I worked in other jobs, if you had admin time, you would put that in. That was in your day, and you'd have a meeting put in your day. Some days teachers have five, depending on how many lessons, but back-to-back lessons with no freeze all day. So you have to do it at home. My partner sat yesterday and was working at home for about 2 hours. Unpaid. On top of the planning, there is data tracking, compliance. I've wrote some things down here. Checking in. And again, as parents, you won't know that. Well, you'll know that everyone has a target. So say my target is a 6. I need to be on that 6. But at the moment, I'm not really working to a 6 because there's stuff going on at home, or I've slipped, I'm a teenager. And the teacher's still then held accountable for that 6. I've been taken out of school, I've been on holiday for a month, so I've missed a month's worth of school, and I've still got to get this 6. So then someone will be on that teacher's back, why is Joanne not a 6? And I can't say as a teacher, well, she's missed a month because she went on holiday, and mum and dad are getting divorced, so she's not really working up to her standard at the moment. And I don't know, maybe she started a period, hormones all over the place, and she is getting a little bit cheeky, she's not paying attention in class. None of those things would stand. You've got to put me down as that 6, whether I've got all of that stuff going on or not, because you'll be on the list because your class is underperforming. Actually then happens is all of this contributes to then teacher burnout, because they're trying to get everyone through everything at such a speed so they can get the results, they can then redo, and then they've got to mark all of this stuff and put all the data on and then have a look at the data, then report, and then you have a meeting about your data and you go through every single student in your class and be proving why they're on that mark, whether it's higher or lower. And all of this, again, is done mostly after school. So when everyone's gone home, you have your data meetings and you're called in, and they're nerve-wracking because it's someone actually scrutinizing what you're saying and what you're doing. And then, like I've just said, if little Johnny's mum and dad are going through divorce and you really know that he's struggling right now and you need to put a 4 because he's not quite a 6, you're still going to put that 6 because you don't want to make that list of teachers that need support because they're not working right. And this is always hanging over, overarching all of the time while you're teaching. But at the same time, you love being in front of the kids. You want to help and support the kids. I think every single teacher that I know has going through some kind of mental health, anxiety, depression. They all do have an exit plan. Not one person that I know who is a teacher is in it for the long haul, because after 4, 5, 6 years, you start to realize that this is not healthy for me. So just in regards to that, I did pick out some information. So across the UK, 78% of education staff reported being stressed, up to 3% on last year. 39% experienced a mental health issue in the last academic year. This is the highest since 2018, and that was November 23. So I'm guessing they haven't done it yet because it's not being a year. And I can vouch for that. I can vouch because being a school teacher and just having these conversations with other teachers in the staff room is mind blowing. And I am just interrupting this transmission to bring you a little bit of Chihuahua and to remind you, and Dorothy wants to remind you, to please like and subscribe. So if you're finding yourself coming to my channel often, if you like what you hear, like what you see, every single like, every single subscription really, really means the world to me. I am planting this podcast seed, YouTube seed, with my bare hands from scratch. At the moment, that I am the editor, the creator, the director, the presenter. So every single little bit of support really means the world to me. It means that I can get on some more amazing guests, grow my podcast, grow my little YouTube studio so that I can bring more of what you like to hear. So thank you, and yeah, get back to the episode.
It's even more mind-blowing is the fact that everyone is there because it's not a high-paid job. We're there because at some point we wanted to make a difference. We wanted to support and educate and inspire. But at the same time, the health and well-being, it's detrimental to health and well-being. And then at the same time, you then have the posts like the one that inspired this podcast, that all teachers are N-A-Z-I. Now, again, if you're listening to this and you had that perception of teachers without even thinking, or, you know, when I speak to other people who are not teachers, I'll flip it and just say, would you stay for 2 or 3 hours after work without any overtime?
Hell no.
Would you work at home at the weekend?
No. Hell no.
Would you work through your lunch?
Hell no.
All of the things that are kind of expected for teachers, no one else would do in their line of work. But it's kind of put on teachers, and they can't moan about it because they're going to get put on the list. It all comes down to this bloody list. So there is a lot of, I guess it's professional isolation. Now, teachers will talk to other teachers, but like I've said, if not in a way that they're going to seek help because of the list, they will talk to their friends, but their friends are also stressed. So you're kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. And, you know, just to reiterate that the reason that I left was because I did go to somebody and say, I don't feel supported in my well-being. And I was told, I was made to cry. You know, I've told the story at the beginning of the podcast. And you know that then you're on the watch list. And I knew that I was going to be on this watch list. A lot of teachers won't actually admit that they're struggling because of this. They'll keep it in. They'll just keep going and going and going. And then what happens? They reach burnout. And then all of this, of course, is then going to have a knock-on effect on their health and also their teaching, the way that they work, because they're not going to have the same passions. So then what happens? They end up on the list because it's affecting what they put out every single day.
And like I've just mentioned, most teachers that I know have an exit plan. Not many out of all of my friends that I know personally, I don't know any actually, sorry, I'm just scanning in my head just to see if I can think of anybody who's in it for the long haul. They're not, or they've all got like a dream, they've all got an aspiration of, right, what am I going to do to get out, or what am I going to, you know, or they're just sticking at it because better the devil, you know. What do you do when you leave teaching if you're so used to being a teacher? Like, if you haven't got a backup plan, what do you do? Where do you go? What we also have is, on top of all of that now, in both countries that I've taught, increased class sizes. Classes are so big, like 24 to 30, 32. I remember in one lesson, one class that I had in the UK, we used to have to pull extra chairs in when that class came in. I think there was 32. And it's impossible, it's high on possible to get around to everybody, to support everybody, to do all of the things they want you to do and get everyone hitting their scores and marking all of their books properly, because there's too many kids to deal with. It's hard enough to remember all of their names. And then again, I'm just going to bring it all the way back full circle, that one teacher that's being called an NAZI on Facebook probably has had to send that email to 10 other parents, and they didn't wake up that morning thinking, I'm going to make this person's life hell. They would have had a memo that says they've still got their jogging bottoms on, what are you doing about it? And I know that a lot of people think teachers are lazy. Hopefully you've gotten this far through the podcast and think, oh, actually, you can't be lazy. You cannot be lazy as a teacher. Like, I don't understand where that misconception comes from, because you don't get time to do anything. Like, not even at lunchtime. Like, most days I'll message my partner and he doesn't get a chance to check his phone throughout the day. At all. You remember, I'd get like 5 minutes maybe at lunchtime and check my personal emails or quickly go on ASOS, you know, but then you get the guilt because if someone sees you checking ASOS and you shouldn't be checking ASOS, like, you have to, you know, quickly log out. Over the years that I was teaching, it got worse and worse and worse every single year. You would hardly, like, my first couple of years, I'd go and eat lunch in another classroom with another teacher. That stopped to my last couple of years. You just work through lunch because you had to, because it was, you didn't have a lesson, so you were able to get stuff done if you weren't on lunch duty or had a lunchtime club. And I know, oh, it's raining. A lot of people, again, don't realise, and I know I've mentioned the governors.
Hello, governor.
These rules and regulations that do get passed down to students, that you need this, you need that, and you've got to have your tie and you've got to wear proper trousers, come from above, these mysterious governors that we never meet, but they run the school. I don't think any of them have ever been teachers, or they're retired teachers, and they want to keep things traditional. And I completely agree that there does need to be a shake-up in schools. There needs to be a shake-up in the curriculum. There needs to be a shake-up in how lessons are taught and, you know, how the school looks. Schools were set up to prepare for factory work. So, you know, you'd have the rows and your bell and waiting to go to the toilets.
You will thoroughly be taught the three R's. Reading.
Do we really need that format? Can it change now? You know, there's more computers now. Could we? I don't know. I don't have the answer, but I do think there does need to be a shake-up. A lot of students, because they're on phones so much now, don't have many real life skills anymore. I think I've shared this in a podcast before, that I said to my class, because I was stressing out, I couldn't log in, something was going on, and I was like, just talk amongst yourselves for a minute. And it was silent, and I was like, have I got something on my face or something? Like, what's going on? So I can remember, I looked up, I said, you can talk amongst yourselves. They were like, but what do we talk about? And I was like, anything, whatever you want. Like, there's no topic, just anything. What did you do last night? They still didn't. And then it took me a couple of minutes to actually think, oh my God, they don't know how. And then the next person put their hand up, can we go on our iPads? I was like, absolutely not. If you can't talk amongst yourselves, I think we need to have a little bit of a switcheroo here. And we're going to talk about how to make small talk, how just to have a conversation. And I can remember making a joke about, in the UK, we talk about the weather because we don't know what else to talk about. They were just like, what? So this was in a UAE school, but they're on their iPads so much that they don't have those skills. And, you know, maybe we need to bring this back in school. iPads and telephones, gosh, let me just tell you this. During COVID, I would have parents messaging me, oh, they're on the phone all day. Excuse me. I'm at home myself, you know, we're in lockdown, like I cannot confiscate their phone, like you need to do that. But then on the flip, we get parents calling. I would have students picking up their phone in lesson. What are you doing? Put your phone away. It's my mom. Surely your mom can contact reception. And then you would hear the mom just carrying on talking. Like, you tell your mom that you need to hang up. It's, honestly, these, so frustrating. And I did have a conversation with one parent, and I did have to say, like, that disturbed 27 other students in the class. Their phone rang, everyone looked, they were all then listening to the conversation because you called, you disturbed the lesson, you disturbed the learning, and you got your daughter, was it daughter? So I can't remember, in trouble. Like, if you desperately need, you need to phone reception and the message will get to them. It was for something silly. The driver has your PE kit, because they all had drivers out here. It wasn't a phone call. And I had to say, so when you were at school, your parents would have called the school to say, get the message. The reception lady would come with a slip of paper, message done. No one was disturbed. This was, I think, where it becomes teachers versus parents. But if I would love, if you can ever, if you're a parent listening to this, if you can ever get into a school, into a classroom, just to observe, you will have your mind blown. And I know that so many parents would reflect, and the amount of parents are like, don't know how you do it, when they had their own children at home for online learning. So again, if you did experience that, just have a little moment of reflection there. Oh my God, I got sidetracked then. It's raining in Dubai. Again, I hope it's not gonna be a flood, but this is, I can hear the kids next door screaming. So I was like, what is going on? And it is raining. And I'm enjoying it because now I can see through the window. Dorothy didn't enjoy. Sorry, just sidetrack there, real-time podcasting. So where was I? So if we're not working together, teachers, and I would say we, I'm not in this anymore, but when we don't support teachers, when teachers are not supported, it does affect the wider community. First of all, when students, when your children see you not supporting the teacher, when they see you not supporting the teacher, this also has an automatic effect on the way that they behave. Now, when I was at school, if I went home and said the teacher had moved me, my mum was like, why, what were you doing? Now, and I've had, let me tell you this story, I had six desks, sixes, I think it was, and there was a group of girls, and I used to call them the mean girls, because
you can't sit with us!
They were, and they were only 12. They were mean, they were so horrible, they were always in trouble for bullying, and they would have to give each other a hug before they went to their individual desks once I'd split them up. But when they were all sat on the same table, they would be practicing their TikTok dances, and they weren't doing any work, so I would, you know, tell them to, come on, you need to do this, and I'd get a big eye roll, and they'd just back chat, and I'd try to keep them in for detention, and they would, you know, and when I say keep them in for detention, it's just finish this work, because someone's going to check your books and someone's going to say to me, why have none of these girls done this work? What have you done about it? So I split them up and I put one on each table, much to the rest of the class dismay, because they didn't want to sit with these mean girls. The next thing I know, probably the next day, 48 hours, I had an email from the pastoral, and she called me in and said that I was being accused of bullying the girls. So I was like, right, okay, get the parents in, because I wanna speak to them. So I think maybe three of the six of the girls' mums came in, and I showed the mums their books, and I used to mark in pink, and it was all pink pen. Why is this not finished? And I used to make sure that I, for my own big backup, that I would write in scene, and I used to put the time as well. And again, this might make me an NAZI, But no way was someone going to check my books and go, look at all this unfinished work, what are you doing about it? Because I would go around like, right, you haven't done any work, it's 10 past 12, I'm going to come back in 10 minutes to see if this is finished. And if it wasn't, I would write it down, still not finished. Or I would, you know, of course I would help them if they need help, and you could see where I've tried to help and give sentence starters, all of the things. So it was clear in the books everything I had done, and I had to explain that they sit, they chat, they're doing the TikTok dances, I'm trying to teach Romeo and Juliet or whatever it was, and they're just making it difficult. They're disturbing the 24 other children in the class. And they did actually then apologize to me, and the behavior changed. But when the parents are not on side, their behavior wouldn't have changed. So it's not just that one child who is playing up, it's then the disturbance, because you can't ignore them completely, because you do get to a point where you have to say, like, can you be quiet or stop doing that? Dogs are barking at the rain, so I'm just gonna have to go. When the parents are supportive, it really does, it really pays off, and it makes the teacher's life a lot easier. Please excuse the dogs barking in the background, they're barking at the rain. So when you are supporting the teachers, now there will be times when you don't agree, but I urge you, and you know, just ask you to not do this publicly, you know, speak to the teacher, because I also guarantee that most of it's not coming directly from the teacher. Unless it's homework or lateness, but again, there will be somebody on the teacher's back. Have these conversations with your teacher, but not in front of your student, because the amount of students, like, my mum doesn't agree with homework. I'm like, okay, but you know, you can't say this to the student, but the head of year's on my back, or head of department's on my back, and the head teacher's on their back, and the governors are on their back, and they want to have this homework book marked, and with all this data and marking and showing how much you've improved, and stickers and blah blah blah. It's not coming from me. But we can't be honest and say that. We just have to bite our lip. So solutions. Now, first of all, within school, teachers really need their self-care prioritized. And this is not a shameless plug, but this is what inspired me to make a toolkit while I'm making my wealth toolkit for teachers, so that they can support their health and well-being and have a place to come in the mentor program that they feel supported. As well as this, having a shift in focus from student performance to teacher well-being, instead of it being the data, you know, how are the kids doing, how are the kids doing, how are the kids doing, and putting it all on the student, take a step back and maybe have a measure of how many teachers are leaving, how many teachers are leaving the school to go to another school, or how many teachers are leaving to leave the profession. And then if that's high, then you know, chase whoever it is above, because there's something not quite right there. Having more retention strategies. When I left the UK, the head teacher then was actually a really nice head teacher, and he did say there'll always be a place for you in school, be sad to see you go. When I left the school in the UAE, no one cared. I was literally replaceable, and they did say to the whole school at some point, not so many words of, you're all replaceable. We knew that, so there was you just knew, like, there was no one was like, oh, please don't leave, what can we do, you know, how can we help. It was like, and then especially here, you get given your contract every 2 years and you have to decide if you're going to stay or go. There are people that just don't get given a contract, so it's quite nerve-wracking. And then, yeah, if you decide to leave, there's no interview of what can you do, was it well-being. You know, a lot of people leave in the UAE because they may be going home, they may be moving countries, but there's no retention strategies. In schools now, if you're a teacher and you have this in your school, please reach out to me. But mental health support, mentorship again, which is what I am offering, I'm going to try and get into as many schools as I can to offer this. Reducing unnecessary admin tasks. Some of the tasks that we were meant, I can't even get my words out. Sometimes you would have an email about an email, you'd have a meeting about a meeting about a meeting, then it'd be in an email, and then you'd have to copy and paste things from one place to another to put it on another document, and they'd just be like, why is this paper trail here? Like, what am I doing? I'm spending all of this time putting numbers into a spreadsheet that no one's going to look at, or someone's going to go in and edit. So just having a way to make these unnecessary admin tasks, you know, not there. We don't need so much of the teacher admin. When you leave teaching, you actually realize you've got files and files and files. These class files, everything's online now. But we would have to have a class file of, these are the kids, these are their needs, these are their allergies. And we were also meant to remember all of this. This is where they sit. This is the seating plan. This is why this is the seating plan. This is my plan for my lesson. You'd have folders and folders and folders. No one would look at them, just you, unless someone came in and asked, which was rare. And then you throw them away and start again in September. I would also say that teachers need safe spaces. They need to be able to go somewhere to speak about their well-being, getting put on the dreaded list, because there's no that. And again, this might happen in some schools now. I've been out of teaching for 2 years, but I didn't have anywhere to go. Even the staff room was not a safe space. The staff room's quite a toxic place. People go in there, and once people start moaning and speaking, it ends up that you just go in and you leave feeling so negative because everyone's on the same vibration. Again, within schools, maybe an emphasis on well-being. Like, we never had like a, okay, obviously it would always have to be after school or within school, you know, we'd have a meeting and there might be sandwiches, but instead, like, you know, we're going to cancel the meeting, go home. That never happened. And I can't remember. Maybe it happened once. And I think for parents to find that happy relationship, to maybe get involved, to try and have more of an understanding of what teachers are doing, why they are there, and the care and the love and the support that they are giving your children. Because, you know, them contacting home because of these trousers is not their priority. That's not why they chose to become a teacher. They chose to become a teacher because, again, they wanted to make a difference. They wanted to do this job because they would felt this call to educate, to inspire, to empower. And it's the most rewarding thing. I was chatting to a few ex-students only a couple of weeks ago on Facebook, and, you know, when they're saying that you helped me and you were my favorite teacher and you really supported me, and now they're in their 20s and they've got their own children, and it's so nice to hear that you had that effect and that's never going to go. But then at the same time, I still then have memories of calling home and saying that your son's called me an effing cow, and the mum saying, oh yeah, that's how he talks to me as well. Oh, instead of having that support there, because that's not okay. And it's not okay to post these things on social media, bad mouthing teachers, when they really do have your children's best interests at heart. And I'd love to hear your own stories, your own feedback, if you're a parent, you know, hopefully that you've heard some things today and you think, oh, okay, it's not this dream job that it's all cracked up to be, that, you know, the teacher that you're having to go at the end of the day because they have sent an email because you've sent the wrong trousers or trainers or no pencil case, has also had probably not had anything to eat, or they've had to skip their lunch, or someone's had a fight that day, or they've not been toilet. The amount of UTIs I used to get when I was bleeding and I was going through all of my hormone issues, I'd be covered in blood some days and you can't go anywhere. I'd feel it coming out, and I know it's really disgusting, but I would have it on my skirt, I would have it in my pants, and I know that's probably too much information. But then having a parent coming up to me and just complaining that I'd given someone homework, and in my head I'm thinking, I'm literally bleeding and I need to go and sort myself out. I'm in pain, I've got cramps, the last thing I want to talk about is the pencil case. And just taking a moment, because behind all of that, there's a lot going on health-wise, well-being-wise, burnout-wise. And yes, they get holidays, but there's planning going on in those holidays. And after 10, 12 hour days, 5 days a week, and being on the computers all day, those holidays are needed, and the holidays are actually getting smaller. Wait, thank you so much for listening. I do want to hear, if you're a teacher, reach out to me. Let me know what you think. Have I said anything that maybe is outdated? You know, I've been out of teaching for 2 years now. Anything that you agree with? Same for parents. You know, let me know what experiences have you had with teachers. And obviously, I'm not a teacher anymore. I can speak frank and open about this now. And, you know, I am making it my mission, once my toolkit is complete in November, to support teachers. So if you're a teacher listening to this and you'd like to know more, again, reach out to me. And because the dogs are going crazy because of the rain and this, yeah. Thank you so much for listening.
Don't want to hear about how well you're settling down at uni or how much growing up you've done in the past 12 months. At best, I am ambivalent towards most of you, but some of you I actively dislike for no other reason than your poor personal hygiene or your irritating personalities. I hope I've made myself clear on this point, and in case any of you think I'm joking, I'm not. I assure you that once my legal obligation to look after your best interest is removed, I can be one truly nasty fucker. Good luck with the rest of your lives, and try not to kill anyone. Reflects very badly on all of us here.